God wants to use us like he used the spies. We are not to judge by appearances. I would not be teaching you here as your Bible teacher today if the girl in the next bed in that hospital when I was 19 years of age had judged me by my appearance. If there was anyone that was an outside inside person, it was me. There was absolutely nothing that was out of place on the outside of my life. And when people looked at me, they said, that girl's got it all together. She's got it all together. But you see, God looked at the empty, lonely, desperate heart. He saw how valueless I felt inside, how worthless I felt inside. And he saw the seeds of faith that had been planted there through one way and another. He saw that I believed that God was, even though it was a very tenuous belief, I did believe that God was somehow in heaven and on earth God. And that's all I did believe. But it was enough, just as it was enough for Rahab. We must not demand so much belief before we tell somebody the Christian gospel. We must not presume that they will not understand. For we must never shortchange what the Holy Spirit has done before we arrive on the scene. And the Holy Spirit had done a lot in Rahab's life. And sometimes we look at what happened, you know, in Joshua 6, we read about the incredible extermination of this whole city. And they'd already done it on the other side of Jordan. They were already going to do it again and again. Why? Because God told them to do it. And we struggle with this. Hebrews 11 gives us a clue because Rahab is mentioned in the heroes of that chapter, the heroes of the faith. And it says that she alone was saved from perishing when the judgment was coming on the city, because those that she lived among were disobedient. And the word means knowingly disobedient. They were not Rahabs. And we can know that if God brings such incredible destruction that is very difficult to understand, he has been there walking up and down the streets beforehand. And we believe, incredible though it is, that God saw only Rahab and gave her the chance to escape the ruin by redemption, by hanging the thread in her life. So Rahab, being an outside inside person and God seeing the inside, was changed, was saved. The spies came in chapter 6 and they carried the trumpets and everything happened as I explained to you. Verse 24, they burned the whole city and everything in it, but they put the silver and gold and articles of bronze and iron into the treasury of the Lord's house. But Joshua spared Rahab the prostitute with her family and all who belonged to her, because she hid the men Joshua had sent as spies to Jericho, and she lives among the Israelites to this day. So she became an inside-outside person. You with me? What was inside after God had changed her started to appear and manifest itself outside. And that's because God turned her inside out. Right? And that's what happens after he delivers us from Jericho. We become an inside-outside person. The real desires of our heart for who we want to be, what we want to do. Don't you ever sometimes think, why did I say that? Or why did I do that? Or why can't I be like that? God can make you all of those things. He lends his power to us that we might be the women that he has created and designed us to be. Matches us up what he has created and designed us to do. And enables us to do it. For God never calls without equipping. He changes us inside. He begins to help us to see the desires of our heart for ourselves come to fruition. He turns us inside out. And that new inside begins to show itself outside. Only God can do this. He deposited her in a whole new, wonderful world. And he gave her a new future. And he gave her a new family. A new family. He gave her God's family, the forever family. And you know, the neat thing about being a believer is that that's what he does for you, and that's what he does for me. When we hang the scarlet thread in our lives, and I hope you're getting that picture, when we do the only thing that's left to do in front of a holy God as a sinful person and say, I apply the life given for me at Calvary to my death, to my nothingness, to my worthlessness, to my valuelessness. I'm a Rahab. I cast myself on your mercy. I am totally at your mercy. I am out of control. I cannot make you, God, do what I would like you to do with my soul. It's your soul. You gave it me. Now, I throw myself on your mercy. And as we do that, he ties that scarlet ribbon all over our lives. And he takes us into a whole new world. Because you see, our salvation is really in two parts. Our salvation is our salvation and our sanctification. It doesn't mean you get saved first and then further down the line, 20 years on, you start and get sanctified. Sanctification is simply making you like Christ. And that can begin the moment you become a Christian. Sanctification actually means setting you apart, totally apart, like the children of Israel were supposed to be set apart, God's people, for him, to work for him and to show him and to manifest him and to preach him and to teach him and to share him and to teach our children about him. Sanctification means a whole new life in a whole new world with a whole new family. Christian believers are our family. Jesus looked around one day and he said, who are my brothers and mothers and sisters and brothers? You are, he said to the crowd, the disciples, the people that were following him. There are new relationships to be found in this wonderful, wonderful forever family that God has brought us into. And that's the marvelous thing, because God enables us to be so changed within that we are knit together with these new people. And then you begin to behave what you believe. Incidentally, everybody behaves what they believe, if you think about that. Sort of rather shattering, but it's true. Everybody behaves what they really believe. Which brings up a question, do you really believe what you say you believe? What is inside will surely show outside, if you really believe it. Because belief is a whole lot more than head knowledge. Belief is trust. Belief is committing yourself to a philosophy of life that you so believe, you've so bought into, that you must live it out. That's belief. And everybody behaves what they believe. We live the God life. Do you want to be a wise woman? Then you've got to be a woman of the word. And how can you be a woman of the word if you don't involve yourself somewhere in the activities of the church, be it in this building or outside this building? We must behave what we believe. We do behave what we believe. Which makes me wonder, what do we believe? Well, we know what Rahab believed, don't we? And we see that she was saved. And she became an inside-outside person. So, little exercise for you to do. Are you an outside-inside person? Or are you an inside-outside person? Or are you an outside-outside person? And you say, what's that? And I'm not going to tell you. You can figure that one out.
Is telling the truth. You've just heard from Jill Briscoe and her message, How to Start All Over Again. Jill's right back to answer key questions about today's